started in 2011 by a group of actors responding to a lack of opportunities for Asian Americans in New York theater. We gathered statistics on the hiring practices of Broadway theaters as well as 16 of the largest off-Broadway theaters, and were the first group to make this information public. Since then, we've organized meetings for our community to discuss these issues and responded publicly to instances of yellowface and brownface at theaters across the country. We have become leaders in the discussion of diversity with our allies in the New York City Theater, and are proud to stand with our partners here tonight, bringing you Beyond Orientalism. And now, it is my great pleasure to introduce tonight's keynote speaker, a star of the stage and screen, one of the rare actors to win all five New York Theater Acting Awards, including a Tony for his performance in M. Butterfly. Please join me in welcoming Bee Bee Vaughn.
Not all of us had negative experiences. I had a lot of positive experiences. combined with this acknowledgement of how we were perceived in the media and represented and all of that, complicated things greatly. And that's why I think we're really a noble group of people, like an army of people, because we overcame that, because we're still freaking here, because in this room, talking about it and trying to fix it, because we are so dedicated to it, because we love it so much, because it means so much to us. So we all have that experience. Specifically, then I entered, I became an actor, and I, in the beginning of my career, which at the time I didn't realize was the beginning of my career, but like, who knew I would go to be so ancient? And what was now the beginning of my career, I was one of many people who participated in the discussion that arose when Jonathan Pryce was brought over to play the engineer in Miss Saigon in the early 90s. And I could talk for hours about this, but I won't do that. I mean, a lot of you, most of us probably know the basics of that story. But what I will share about it is a real naive feeling that both David Wong and I felt at the time when we first discussed this. And David Wong and I were at dinner or some party or something like that, and David said, hey, you know, there's this show. And he kind of basically explained it, and then he explained this whole situation with Jonathan Pryce. And at the time, another actor, the actor who was playing Tui, both of whom were in full-on yellow drag, right? They were in full-on prosthetics and gold foundation and all that stuff. And the two of them were in the West End, and we were like marveling at the Marco Polo movie that was made in 2006. And I was to play Marco Polo. Marco Polo was played by a former guest model, let's just call him that. And I was to play his trusty slave. Now, I didn't have to be a, you know, kind of bowing and scraping slave. I had a great deal of dignity. He treated me well and all that stuff. But I was still slave. And I was branded and stuff like that. What I'm saying about this is I want to respond to the groans, because it really wasn't the nature of the part that I felt undignified by. It was a perfectly fine part, but he was, in fact, a slave, and that kind of tells you the food chain of how actors are hired and what the Asian part was actually going to end up being in that show. But there was also another star in the movie, and that star was the actor playing the role of Kublai Khan, famous person. And I signed on to do, I believe I signed on to do the movie, and then was told that Brian Dennehy was playing. Brian Dennehy was playing Kublai Khan, and then I got on the phone with the director of the movie, Kevin Connor, who was British. And he was very, very nice to me and very, very sweet, and I continued to do this thing that we are doing tonight, which is this exhausting thing of pushing the thing and not taking no for an answer, and she's continuing to push him about. He was constantly skirting the conversation to another kind of subject. And I was like, okay, now what about Brian? Can we talk about Brian for a second? Because you understand, like, I'm a member of a certain community, and there's a lot of history of blah, 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 blah. And this is where you fade out, you just hear me, you see my lips moving, all the stuff that we're constantly talking about. And he eventually agreed that, I see, understood that this whole idea of yellowface was wrong. He said, Brian, well, you're absolutely right. He can't be in yellowface. He can't be in the list. You know, he's still playing the part. I can't get him fired. But he's not going to be in yellowface. And I said, well, you know, because that means, you know, he can't wear, like, prosthetics on his eyes. Because, you know, that would be bad. Right. And he can't wear a colored foundation or, you know, blah, 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 blah. And he said, yes, absolutely, absolutely, you're absolutely right. So that we had this conversation. And then afterwards, I sent him an email. And the email said, oh, it's so nice to talk to you. As per our conversation, I'm so glad to hear you say he won't be wearing makeup and all of that stuff. And then that was fine. He answered back, thank you, all that stuff. And so I sent that email, and he sent an email back. And then I got on the plane, and I went to China. And when I got to China, Kevin said, yeah, you know what? Brian's had a change of Brian would like to do some makeup tests, and he's going to do some makeup tests with him. So this is a whole long story, which I blogged about, and I will publish for you someday. Because it's super interesting about what happened from day to day, like from Monday through Thursday. Monday through Friday of this week when I was in China getting ready to shoot, and they said, yeah, Brian's decided he wants to do makeup tests. And I said, well, actually, and I never thought I would ever say this, but I said, actually, I think that if Brian is more than happy to do these things, but we did have this discussion, and you said he wasn't going to do that, so I'll just go home, and I will be like, you know, okay, I don't really want to, I'm so nice to work with him, blah, 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 but I'm just going to go home. And they were into that, I mean, alarmed by the idea of that for whatever reason. Well, partly because we're shooting them like the next day. I was any good or anything like that. A warm body to the random. And so I just said I'd be happy to go home, and I told my agents backed me up and all that stuff. And there was a whole crazy convoluted thing where Brian Denny was doing these tests, and we were supposed to wait until the test was over. They were going to send me the photographs and I was supposed to approve them. But my agents, very mindful of my dignity, said the other people will leave the room while you look at the pictures, and then you can decide for yourself so that you're not put on the spot and have to say, you know, I'm going to say no anyway. Yeah, baby, you're going to say no. This is at least a mechanism that allows you to say no that is somehow, you know, backed up by this, whatever, this whole negotiation term. At the end of it, I decided to stay because they eschewed the use of prosthetics. And I agreed, okay, I sold out, I agreed to brown contact lenses. And he wore brown contact lenses. And very much like what happened with Jonathan Pryce when Jonathan Pryce came over and eschewed the prosthetics. He didn't wear the prosthetics anymore. He didn't wear the base anymore. He just was Jonathan Pryce and a red jacket. they were saying like that. They said he would not, and they were okay with it. Brian was kind of mad at me and stuff like that. Didn't talk to me. But the fact was that they looked kind of dumb. I mean, you can't win when you're the guy. When you're the guy in yellowface, really. I wish I could tell these guys how they're not going to win. Because you can't win when you have the yellow face on, and you can't win when you take the yellow face on. You're in the wrong part. End of that. The point of it is that the recurring theme for me is English. Because both Kevin Connor and Cameron McIntosh, and even Jonathan Pryce himself, don't really fully take to heart what we're talking about. They don't feel it. They don't get it. And that is because their tradition of actors transforming themselves, white actors, transforming themselves, playing whoever they want, crossing across race, painting themselves up, and doing all sorts of things like that, is as deeply entrenched in them as our pain is in us. And to say that I don't mean to be cynical, but the fact is, I think we get ourselves into trouble when we think about changing it. The power to me in the war of this is acknowledging where they are coming from, acknowledging that they're almost handicapped. Their way of thinking, or they're almost mentally handicapped. Because, and so with a mentally handicapped person, you cannot continue to try to get it's like speaking louder to a deaf person. Right? You can't continue to do that, it's not going to do any good. So what is the strategy? There are a million strategies, we'll talk about them tonight. There are strategies in which you work around, or you understand and acknowledge, or you negotiate. I believe that there are wonderful, we're very lucky tonight, we have wonderful people who are artistic directors of formidable theatrical New York institutions, right? And I have had the great pleasure of working with some of them and also working with others at regional theaters across the country, many of whom either get what we're talking about and subscribe to it and believe for their learning. And I believe that a big part of this is an educational kind of thing, a thing about kind of making them understand where we're coming from. Okay, Matilda Swinson thing, all of these things that we could see in the video, these things are always things that have happened already, right? And then we're always stuck in that position where we're reacting to them, and we're always kind of trying to change them. We're trying to get them to somehow not happen, but we can't really do that. I mean, I believe very strongly in the passion and the commitment that many people in this room have to eradicating this phenomenon, particularly because when we first experienced this phenomenon, we were young people, and we understand we don't want young people like our kids and our grandkids to experience that kind of shameful feeling, which does a number on our being able to interface with the rest of the world. It's just a question. And so my answer to this thing is all about getting them to understand the pain and the history and all that. Because I would like nothing more. I better be careful about how I say this, because I actually really don't want this, but I do want to say that I want this. I would love to play a white person, right? You know what I mean? I would love the opportunity to play a white person. Because I see them doing it all over, up and down, up one side and down the other. And that's like totally weird. Like the default place is that a white person is like neutral and can like add to themselves, and that we can't do that. And the reason why we can't do that is because that English sensibility, let's just call it that, you know, I know it's not just that, but that English sensibility is really deeply entrenched. And we're trying to overcome that, and we don't have a foothold in counteracting it at all, because we're still also, there's just constantly trying to get them to stop doing that. We can't even get to the place where we're doing what we really want to do and experimenting with our own creativity because we can't get them to understand whatever. So a lot of us feel that we need to do these things in a certain order and that we cannot succeed or we cannot feel good about ourselves if we skip to the place where we're playing white people. And we want them to see what they're doing is wrong first, we want them to fix it, and then we want to take the stage and start being creative. I don't think that order is necessarily an order that is terribly useful. I think we should start doing it. Yes. I think we can start doing it. And I think the next radical production a really interesting theater that starts exploring cross-racial casting, and it doesn't even mean whiteface, it just means playing parts that are outside of where we look, can be very valuable and can be really interesting and can be a way for us to take the edge off of this pain. Because the other thing that I want to say about this is all our behavior is constantly informed by our pain. And it's never good to enter a battle when you are like dealing with your own kind of feelings and your own baggage and your own, you know, because like what I said before, the way this all makes me feel does a number on my self-esteem. It makes me feel bad about myself. It makes me feel bad. And I'm way better about it now than I used to be. But when I first started this, I had very low self-esteem as an Asian actor entering a very competitive field because these images did a number on me. It made me feel less than, or made me feel like, oh, well, shit, I can't do that, or I can't do this, whatever. And as I let that go, and I start realizing that I have worth, and that my worth is creative and interesting and vital and sexy and full of value, that then I stop wanting to change the other thing, what the other people are doing. I start being able to say, okay, let them freaking do this stupid thing. I'm going to do this, and it's going to be fucking fabulous. And I wish that for us. You know, I wish that for us in a great way. I was getting some talking points, and I just want to remark on a couple of talking points that I was given. One is the idea of allies, and we are talking about allies and people. Now, I believe that the allies, in my definition, because this starts to get really like we need white people to save us, and I do not like that. I just can't have that. So I do understand, though, that there are artistic directors and that there are people, Howard Sherman, people that get it, that know us, and that spreading that joy joyful word about what is so great about non-traditional casting, about casting across race and all of that stuff, and colorblind casting, all these complicated issues. Spreading that word is absolutely paramount. And that what we really want, what we really want is for the educational level to be raised. We want people to get it more. So that when they're doing the Tilda Swinton thing, there are more people who are not us, who are saying, oh, that's really uncool. Okay, so it happened and bullshit like that, but it's really uncool. And then it starts maybe chipping away a little bit at their confidence in doing it. Because they're so fucking confident when you do it.
Wonderful. 38% of roles went to actors of color. African Americans gained the most, from 13% the year before to 26% this year, a new high for the 9 years we have data. And Asian American actors increased to 7% from 5% the year prior. In fact, every single major not-for-profit institution that we ran numbers for hired people of color in this season, except for one, that was MCC Theater. But the last point that I want to make, because I didn't want to go into this to have this really interesting conversation, is about non-traditional casting. And that's where I find the most troubling news, actually. Because even though the industry is trending upwards in terms of hiring actors of color, non-traditional casting has largely remained stagnant over the past 9 years. And so that means it's great, you know, if it's great for Asian actors if we have a show like The King and I on Broadway, but if you don't have a show like that, the numbers are going to go back to the 2%. It was at the year before King and I was on Broadway. And it's interesting to note that Asian Americans were the least likely to be able to be non-traditionally cast. They were the least likely to be able to transcend their race. And perhaps there's a connection between that and our invisibility and all the yellowface that continues to happen. So to answer that question, we've assembled a great group of panelists for you. I'd like to invite the panelists to come up. As I introduce to you our facilitator for the evening, we're so lucky to have her. Her name is Carmen Morgan. She's the founder and director of Art Equity, which is a national program that provides tools, resources, and training to support the intersection of art and activism. She has worked with over 100 institutions to try to break down institutional bias. So please give it up for our panel and Connor Morgan.
Of the experience on this panel. So we're going to tackle a lot of issues from a lot of different perspectives. So I'm just going to quickly, I want to really encourage you all to read the bios. I am not going to do justice to this incredible group of folks here. I'm just going to be saying their names and allowing you to see, connect faces and names. But please read their bios and you'll learn more about who they are in terms of their context and talking and responding. So, to my right, I was told that you all were going to be sitting in a particular order, so I sure hope you did. I know to my right is Nelson. Nelson Eusebio, who I have a pleasure of working with and I know quite well. And then to Nelson's right, Mia Katipa. Mm-hmm. Mia's with us. And then to Mia's right, James Nicola, right? Manage Expectations, right? We support you all in supporting us on that. And then, while this is an incredible panel here, a lot of experience and expertise on this stage, it's clear that many perspectives are not going to be represented here. It's clear that our diversity, while it is present, is limited. There's some gender opportunities, I would say. And also, racial and ethnic lines as well. So we just want to speak to that, that we can do what we can do. And then connected to that is obviously each person is going to be speaking from their own perspective. They will obviously not be representing an entire group of people. And then the other piece that I want to say is that just, you know, we'll be having opportunities for you all to speak with each other in smaller groups and then also ask questions of the panel. And you know the basic, general, operating group agreements that are always present. You know, everybody speak for themselves, mutual respect. You all know, I see people nod. You all know the drill. So those are operating in this room here. Recognizing that there are going to be varying perspectives. We will not all agree, but we don't have to stop the conversation because of that. Let's just know that that is a given. And then the other thing I want to just share with you all, I want to speak to, the other thing I want to just say is the video touched upon this. I think Bidit touched upon this as well, and I just want to put it out there, just in the interest of respecting the deep, deep injuries that a lot of these images and really racism inflicts on us. We're going to have a conversation here tonight where these issues are going to be hitting some of us very differently. For some of us, there's just no way we can look at those images and have it be a intellectual exercise. It is steeped in the histories of our communities, of our lives. We have reaped the racist impact of them. And so having a conversation is not going to be dispassionate. It is not going to be disconnected from those experiences and those histories. We just need to name that. We don't want to keep re-injuring ourselves even as we have these conversations in the service of justice. So just to put that out there, that there just needs to be some thoughtfulness and some sensitivity about whose comfort we are prioritizing as we have these conversations in the service of justice. So having said that, I think we've tilled the soil, and now we're going to jump right into our first question. Are folks ready for that? Okay. So let's see. You know, I was going to tee this up, but I got a little note saying that we're, you know, in terms of time, I'm not going to tee this up very much. I'm just going to go straight into this. Folks, when we think about these images and we think about the body of work that we have here on what we call the classics and what is in our canon, I want to put to you all this question. How do you update a classic? How do you update a classic in a way that is respectful to what it was representing at its time and also takes into account 21st century sensibilities? And I want to start with you, David, as the executive director for New York Gilbert and Sullivan. You've got some experience with this, so let's start with you.
Thanks very much, Carmen, and thank you to everyone, all of our hosts who invited me here tonight. It's very exciting to be here. So I will speak to this from our process, like you explained, and from our process since, frankly, our eyes have been opened, since we've been awakened to the need for change surrounding the Mikado and one of our pieces, main pieces of our repertoire. The first thing that we decided that we needed to update this piece, this classic, is a 100% commitment of new energy, that we need to come to the piece new. And in fact, one of the advisors that we've worked with since our process began in September, spoke to the fact that theater is a living organism, right? Even in our own mission statement, our mission statement says giving vitality to the living legacy of Gilbert and Sullivan. So you have those words of vitality and living in the mission statement. We've even been known for this, for updating, for bringing pieces to a modern audience over as part of our brand, as part of our what we do. Gilbert and Sullivan themselves, in our case, Gilbert and Sullivan themselves were noted to update shows as they toured them into New York with topical references that an audience would understand and make it more accessible for audiences to understand. So certainly the history is there and the possibilities are there for satire to be updated. That was just a quick background. But the first step that we committed to was coming at this with a new energy as a new effort. We're not going to patch something of the past. That we were going to create a new team. For the first time in 40 years, our board of directors has committed to an all-new production of The Mikado, including a new director. That's the first director to hold that title in 40 years in our company. Set designer, costumes, everything, and openness to working with a member of the Asian American community, Japanese American community, as part of the creative team. That was a big one. And that took a lot of internal work. Yeah. And for a lot of reasons, for a lot of the difficulty that was expressed before, a lot of the things that BD said. Secondly, I think it's important to reach out to the communities that have had this consciousness and this personal experience. The experience that BD was talking about that's almost impossible for others to understand. And in doing that, we've met with some incredible, brave advisors over the past 6 months. And my heart goes out in thanks to all of them. And I'm really thankful, and it warmed my heart that they're all here tonight, which is amazing to me. So thank you guys for that. In that reach out, it became clear, understanding both our nature as an Actors Equity repertory company that has a sort of a situation where we, you know, we cast for 13 repertoire shows, 13 productions. That we have on a rotating basis. And the realization that we came to with our advisors is that the path forward for us is to reimagine the piece. And one of the driving forces of that, I think, is that by reimagining the piece, you actually, and this was came out in a great meeting with actors of the Asian American community at Actors Equity, by reimagining the Mikado, you actually create a safer place for actors of Asian descent and all actors of all ethnicities to embrace and find that the Mikado is something that they could enjoy performing and that they can tell the story of by reimagining the piece. So once we committed to that, we now walk the very fine line, which you've mentioned, which BD mentioned, of the very difficult line of how you maintain the artistic integrity, but remove cultural appropriation. Mm-hmm. And I mean in all of its forms, the forms that were represented up on the screen just a few minutes ago. And that's our mission now, and that's the line that we're walking now, and that's what we're committed to. So.
Well, NACO produces European and American classics as written with all Asian American casts without putting them in an Asian cultural context, immediately contemporizing these plays. That's pretty much almost verbatim what we wrote down in our founding and organizing documents. We do this repertory this way because we can. And surprise! And we're changing the schedule, BD. And also because what I find is that seeing the multiplicity of Asian American ethnicities and cultures on stage, for me, depicts more accurately the actual vibrancy and dynamism of American diversity. And also what we've found is that with our productions, we've managed to encourage and provoke a lot of discussion and thought about the consistently topical issues of race and culture. And I'm going to give three examples. When we did Othello, our Othello was also Asian American, and I remember a very long discussion with our director who said, well, you know, otherness and differences, those are pretty key components to the plot. How are you going to make Othello other if he's also Asian American? So that gave me a really good opportunity to talk about how Asian is not a monolith, that the latest count, which was I think 2 or 3 years ago, there's at least almost 30 different cultures in Asia, and that sadly there are prejudices among those different cultures. The actor that we eventually cast, we were told, well, you know, he doesn't look Asian, and his last name doesn't sound Asian, and that brings the opportunity for talking about what does Asian look like now in the 21st century. And the interesting thing was, out of a cast of 12 people, our Othello was the only one who could speak his native tongue fluently. He actually spoke two. He spoke Tagalog and Visayan. so then falsetto land. Can Asian Americans be Jewish? Yeah. And actually, Rabbi Angela Buchdahl is an Asian American and has been cited by Newsweek as one of the 50 most influential rabbis in the country, and by the Jewish Daily Forward as one of the top five. She is the senior cantor at Central Synagogue, which is one of the largest congregations in New York. So way back in 1998, we were saying that these, you know, Asian American Jews in our falsetto land was not an anomaly. Then the third and last example is our most recent production, which was Awake and Sing. And can Asian Americans be... can Asian Americans be Jewish? Yeah. Well, actually, I thought that Bessie was very Filipina, and I modeled a lot of her on... right? I modeled a lot of her on my mother's stepsister. And one of our actors, Sanjit Da Silva, said, actually, the burgers are very Sri Lankan. And there were five Asian cultures represented in that cast, and we all played one family, and we lived in one apartment in the Bronx, dealing with financial hardship. And one of the characters, played by Henry Yaku, played my husband, has a line that says, in a very, very fraught moment in the show, says, but I'm not foreign born, I'm American. And that, to me, has so much resonance that's very specifically 21st century. So we do these productions with a lot of responsibility and rigor and creativity, and we do not do them by changing our skin color or the contours of our features, because we don't need to. We don't need to in order to tell the truths of these characters. And by not changing the way we look, I think we challenge what is still, to me, very distressingly, the stereotypes that persist about Asian Americans, and we challenge the persistent practice of severely limiting the kind of roles that are available for us. And my most fervent hope is that the rest of American theater will, you know, get on the program and update already.
Yes. Well, one of the things that we are fascinated by at New York Theatre Workshop is how present experience, either personal or collective, is shaped and contoured by past collective or individual experience, and then how the present experience might begin to suggest where the future is. So one of the things that we have always been interested in are some of these troublesome voices from the past. And it's my personal belief that it's worse to ignore them and lock them up and sort of pretend they're not there, and that it's better to try and confront them and really see what's there, and maybe there might be some surprises. So anyway, two things that came to my mind that are actually not things we've done, but are things that are in the atmosphere that we're talking about, and they happen to be projects with two of these panelists, actually. And they're sort of suggesting experience I've had addressing this question of how do you look at these things from the past. One of them is a play by Eugene O'Neill called Marco Millions. And this came about because I don't even remember how, but I read the 1923 New York Times review of Marco Millions. And what I read was a story that in 1923, O'Neill had written a play about the dangers of capitalism and colonialism combined. And I thought, wow, this is, maybe there's a way that a play from 1923 that's, you know, well removed from our present reality could be a very interesting and powerful fable. And I thought, but how does New York Theatre Workshop approach a play that is full of very dangerous opportunities for yellowface? So I started a conversation with Mia, actually, and thought maybe this is a way our two theaters could combine and work together, or we would look at this together in some way. So we've now done two different readings with a director that we both admired, Ruben Palendo. And we're still in that discussion. So, and both of those readings yielded very interesting information. And there's for sure something interesting in there. I don't know where this is going to go, but it's been a very interesting and fruitful exploration. Pardon?
Marco Polo's going to be Asian American. Marco Polo's going to be Asian American.
Yes. And the other one is Che Yu has done a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful version of a Chekhov play called A Winter People that we are still really excited about. And we're kind of exploring who that director might be, and that seems to be the question right now. And one of the angles of discussion is could we actually find a Chinese director to come and work with us, and whether that's a good idea or not. And so this is a discussion on the table as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Certainly would like to hear from Nelson as a freelance director, producer, award-winning filmmaker. Please bring it on us.
So I guess just from a freelancer's point of view, who maybe generates their own projects in a different way, in a much more street kind of way. When I think about how you update something, update a classic so it doesn't sort of offend, I think about the fact that when we are doing work as artists and as directors, and we're doing these analyses of the structures of a play, we also need to do our own sort of, and this is, we need to do our own self-analysis. We need to understand as artists, where do we have privilege? Where do we have power? And where are our blind spots in making this work? Certainly, even as a director of color and a filmmaker, I have plenty of blind spots as a cisgendered straight male, and things that I don't understand and things I have questions about. But those are places and things that I think about on a consistent basis. In Lloyd's play, I keep thinking about Lloyd's play, Charles Francis Chan Jr.'s Oriental Murder Mystery, and I keep thinking about that monologue about that K.K. Mogi gives about the discovery of when she gets to be white, and she's like, I feel so bad about what's happening to people of color, blah blah blah, and now I don't have to feel bad about it because I have the privilege of forgetting about it because I'm white. That's not really something that artists of color and certainly Asian Americans can ever sort of forget about, but we still possess blind spots. But when I think about working with historically white organizations that aren't thinking about these issues, I think a lot of times I'm trying to figure out how much awareness they might have around these issues. And still, as much as possible, whenever I get a chance, I am always thinking about how I can have more people of color, more diverse voices, either on our design team, when we cast, et cetera. Great. So I think for me, the one thing I would add to the discussion, other than everything that everyone has said, is that A, there are resources out there. The number of times that someone decides they want to do an Asian American play, like when they did, when The Signature did a whole season of David, the number of emails I got from The Signature that were like, do you know any Asian actors? You know, like that, those kinds of resources, but also understanding that there are communities out there, there's community out there that can support these needs, but there's also a need for the institution or the organization that's reaching out to have an understanding of its own privilege and power and blind spots in the creation and the casting of the work. And always, 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 and I say this not just because I am a director of color, but it's much easier to be diverse or make sure you are not offending somebody by actually having people of color sitting on the other side of the table, always.
Thank you very much. Lots of different approaches from different perspectives, and I think the one common piece that's clear is you just have to bring a high level of consciousness and awareness to this. So thank you. I want to move to this next question that's really important. Let's talk about cultural appropriation. You know, this is at the heart of this conversation. And as an entry point, I want to just define it. I want to make sure that we're all talking about the same thing. And I've got two definitions. One is just simply Wikipedia. Cultural appropriation is the adoption or use of elements of one culture by members of a different culture. But then I want to share with you my favorite definition of cultural appropriation by Deep Tran, who, if you have not read the article, Keep Your Hands Off My Kimono, White People, can I please encourage you to read this tour de force article? Thank you. Absolutely. It is from this article that I share with you this definition. Cultural appropriation is not just outright stealing. It is relegating any trace of non-white ethnicity to set dressing while not employing people of color as performers or on your creative team. It's putting white actors in kimonos or leather dresses so that white artists can have a conversation about white culture with white audiences. It's frolicking in a fantasy place and pretending the people who live in the actual place don't exist. Okay, so let's get to that. Yes.
Who's up first?
Absolutely. So the question that I've got to ask you all here is the million-dollar question. What is this line between artistic freedom and cultural appropriation? I think we often hear them being pitted against each other. Let's start with Alexis. Alexis.
Oh, I have no idea.
Oh. Alexis.
I have one.
I'll give you a minute to get yourself prepped. As a theater critic, it would be lovely to hear from your perspective.
Yeah. So short answer, I don't know. Slightly longer answer. I wanted to start with a story which is not specifically about yellowface, brownface, whitewashing, but about 18 years ago, I was just starting out as a professional theater critic, and I was very nervous and very concerned to do a good job, and I was sent to a musical adaptation of the Lysistrata, LYZ, exclamation point, Liz, which probably tells you most of what you need to know. It was very bad. It was a very bad show by, you know, a white team, and it was updated, of course, so instead of the Greeks and the Trojans, there were white people and black people. And, oh no, it gets so much worse. Wait for it. So the women refused to stop having sex until the white men stopped day trading and over-consuming, and the black men stopped selling drugs and guns. Yeah, I know. Do you know there were letters to the editor saying I don't have a sense of humor because I didn't like... I mean, it's true, I don't have a sense of humor, but there were some very good reasons not to like it. So sometimes it's easy. Sometimes the line between artistic freedom and cultural appropriation is very easy to draw, okay? That was bad art. You don't get to culturally appropriate. Other times, I think it's a lot more complicated. I was really trying to think through this because, of course, you know, who's going to come on and say that they're anti-freedom? You know, I'm secret, fun fact, I'm pro-freedom. I want writers to write what they're passionate about. I want directors to see through their vision. Same for producers. I want them to realize their work as greatly as possible. But I also believe that if we don't take into account the prejudices that exist consciously and unconsciously surrounding gender, surrounding sexuality, surrounding race, that's not freedom. Right? I think that that's really limited. I think it's a really limited approach. And so I think all of these things have to be taken into consideration. I do sometimes worry that if we go too far in the other direction, that we risk a kind of literalism. And I don't think we want literalism in our theater. I think that we realize that the theater is a symbolic space, that the theater is a playful space, and that the theater is about performance, and that people can perform what is not their gender, right? People can perform what is not their sexuality. People can write what is not their gender, what is not their race, what is not their sexuality. And so we just have to be careful and we have to be conscious because we all live and participate in this world that we are doing it consciously, that we are doing it thoroughly, that we are making choices and that we know why we are making them and that we are not taking the easy route. And that we are not just falling back on knee-jerk, okay, that's the way it was always done. So I want all of the freedoms and I want all of the responsibility because I'm in the theater 5 or 6 nights a week and I'm angry so much.
Thank you.
And it's boring, so I want to be angry less.
Thank you for that perspective. Thank you. Jane.
I do new plays, so when I do new plays, there are not a lot of cultural appropriation because it's usually written by a person of a certain background, and sometimes what is complicated would be sometimes having that conversation now as an artistic director explain how Muslims behave in that certain play. And I recently worked on an Akhtar play called The Who and the What, and I was given an opportunity to actually match. My thing about finding directors and playwrights is to sometimes to mix it up because I believe true integration comes from building bridges that one can understand from each other, actors, and having a diversity in the design team and creative team is important to me. But all that to say basically that there were moments where, oh, why don't we put this Islamic Arabic sign as a set dressing and you can walk through without walls, and I have to explain to some extent, well, we are orientalizing these people. And I kept writing a lot of notes, and the director, God bless him, wonderful, wonderful man, finally said it was the first time in his 30 years in directing he's given the race card by an Asian American. Because he himself is actually a person of color. I actually second what Alexis basically said. I think we do borrow as artists, and sometimes I just recently did the play with Lucas Nathan, and I borrowed a Japanese technique by using kabuki clappers. I think the question then becomes, are you borrowing intelligently? Are you stealing thoughtfully? Are you co-opting these things and making it into something else? I think the thing about cultural appropriation is, let's just do it because it's really cool, because as a result of this, we are not thinking as much of it, but just being in someone's shoes and culture, and that creates a bad message. And I think what really happens, and not to bring Edward Said into the conversation, that makes us and other people think, oh, well, look, as Asian Americans, and BD has articulated it so beautifully, what it means personally on our personal level. I can tell you what white people can think of us, because it reinforces a vision, an experience, a perspective in the way they think about us. That's how they will vote. That's how they will see us. That's how they will actually employ us. So I think these sense of cultural appropriation comes from one wonderful place, I think. If you're going to do it honestly, do it thoughtfully, and actually do due diligence. I think a person of another background can write another play. Our Asian American playwrights have written plays that are non-Asian American. I think the other side is truthful. But the big question becomes this: how truthful is it, and are you stealing, I would say, beautifully? Some of the best artists steal. And I think the question then becomes up to you to what you want to do with that to make that yours. I'll end up on one thing too. Anne Bogart didn't steal. She borrowed, she fused, she learned with Suzuki how to create this wonderful thing called viewpoints. I also say the same thing for Julie Taymor. She didn't go to Bali and just pick up a few tricks and then did the Lion King. She found interesting insights to how they create us masks. And I've seen it, I've also seen what she has done also in terms of ceremony, in terms of rituals and puppetry to actually create her own version of the Lion King. It is possible. And that's my point.
Thank you.
I've already forgotten everything that I had planned on saying. I think the idea of artistic freedom is an interesting one. I echo what both Che and Alexis have said about responsibility, and I don't think responsibility and freedom are exclusive. I think they're exactly the same thing. I think with freedom comes a great deal of responsibility. If you're going to own freedom, you have to do it responsibly. I think it's part of the craft of playwriting. As you know, Che mentioned, playwrights, you know, by design, if you're going to write a two-character play, you're going to be writing various sides. But I think it's part of that craft to be able to do that responsibly. I think that any art exists in conversation with the world. I think theater in particular exists in conversation with collaborators and in conversation with audiences in the present tense. So I think it can't be divorced from that responsibility to your collaborators. If you're going to ask a person to play a particular role that's from a perspective that's different than yours, you better understand and give them something that allows that actor to feel human in that role. And if you don't, you're not following the craft. That's just bad craft. So I think that's part of that responsibility. I think that this question about what the line is between that and cultural appropriation, and I should actually pause for a second and say that this notion of cultural appropriation is defined in Deep Trans article. It's been said before and visualized in the video, but I think it's important to continue to reiterate. It's not theoretical and it's not political. It's emotionally painful. It's humiliating and demeaning, and it hurts. And I think that it's easy to think about it in terms of in trying to draw a line of saying, what can I get away with? And I think there's an insidious version of that question that I've been asked a number of times. It's the same thing as that Kublai Khan story of like, what about this? What if we did this? What if we did this? Like, how far can I go? How many times can I punch you in the face before I'm not allowed to do that anymore? And I think that is something that I felt myself in danger of getting used to. And I think that that question of like, what is that line between artistic freedom? It's like, who's artistic freedom? Why do you want to punch me in the face? Why do you want to appropriate? Why do you want to see how far you can go? Who is that for? You know, what conversation are you trying to have in the world? And why does it involve trying to see how much you can take from us? And I think even in a bigger notion than that, I think that cultural appropriation, yellowface, brownface, I think that's... you know, it's insidious, it's dangerous, it's scary, but I also think it's just a symptom of something that's much, much larger. It's the fact that, you know, I'm not just talking about Donald Trump, I'm talking about, like, one of the things that I've become very aware of is that there are people who want to be allies, who want to understand, who are in this room, who are watching on HowlRound, who are engaging in this conversation. There are a lot more people in the world who disagree with what we're talking about than agree. A lot more people. A lot more people in America, and a lot more people who are vocal on message boards and sending emails to people. They're just more and more vocal. And I think that's what we're up against. We're not just up against the image. We're also up against the absence, the thing that makes it you know, that makes us absent on stages, that makes us absent in the media. Not just appropriated, but absent. How many images can be up here when you look at, like, how many movies have no Asian anything? That's another problem, right? Because the fact of the matter is, Asian America is not understood in the majority perception and majority culture as being part of America. Asian American history is not considered part of American history. It's not taught as part of American history. Asian American future is not thought of as something that people think about when they think about the future of America. But I think that what I'm talking about, I mean, you know, I'm a new play guy too. And if you look at the Mayi Writers Lab, if you look at these 30 Asian American playwrights who are doing amazing work, like historically significant work. I mean, when you talk about, you know, I'm going in a little bit of a circle here, but when you talk about artistic freedom, part of that too is about thinking about whose artistic freedom are we concerned about? Are we concerned about the artistic freedom of people who are trying to appropriate stuff? Or are we concerned about the artistic freedom of the people who are trying to do something and provide an alternative narrative? Trying to provide different narratives of what it is to be an Asian American artist and to have an Asian American voice and to exist as an Asian American in the world. And I think when we start to unpack that and when we start to allow and pay attention to those 30 Asian American playwrights, the large communities of Asian American actors, a lot of you who are in here, what kind of freedom do you have? What kind of artistic freedom do you feel you have? I know that, you know, we can talk about what kind of artistic freedom Jim Sturgis thinks he might want to have, or Tilda Swinton might think she wants to have, but what kind of artistic freedom do you have? And I think that, you know, most of what I do is not talking about the things that are bad, you know? It's not, I don't spend a lot of time trying to look at what's out there and try to tear it down. I spend a lot of time, as a playwright, as somebody who's working at the LARC in support of hundreds of writers a year, trying to look for ways to promote equity, promote access, provide a voice to the voice to people who feel voiceless. And I think that that's something that you know, I'm concerned about their artistic freedom.
Yeah, that what Lloyd just said about the danger of getting used to things kind of struck me very deeply, because I feel like, having been an artistic director now for 23 years, I spend every year sort of trying to wake up to what America is, try to wake up to different stories from different writers, different ways of casting, and I think that's part of sort of what is exciting to me about being here, is what's exciting to me about working in this field. In thinking about the question, I kept thinking about the word appropriation and how much I don't like that word generally. I thought about it, just the idea of in relationships or any sort of the idea that we would appropriate something. Seems antithetical to most things, and I think I don't believe in it. And in terms of everything we're talking about, yeah, it doesn't make sense. It, to me, in art, it's about cultural celebration, maybe cultural influence. And speaking to what Che was saying, there's something I believe very much in mixing things up, in trying to sort of celebrate all of these different stories that we have, and hearing different points of view and putting people together. Yet there's also cases where there's specific stories, in the case of this Rajiv Joseph play that we just did, Guards at the Taj, specific stories that demand specific things. And so you're philosophically what the Atlantic's all about is serving the story of the play, and part of serving the story of the play is serving the playwright and the playwright's intentions, and hopefully serving the director in service of the playwright's intentions. And yet, like some of the other people have said, there's times when artistic freedom is amazing, and there's also times when I've heard people sort of use artistic freedom as a crutch to get their way, maybe not in service of the story, but actually in service of their own appropriation, possibly. So I guess as I'm doing this job and trying to do the best I can, I'm sort of constantly trying to learn about how best to serve stories while also not putting people in boxes. Because I feel like there's a combination of saying, you know, you can do this play and it's those people over there, and you can do this play and it's those people over there. And yet there's something about the entire community and celebrating the specificity of these stories, but also celebrating the coming together of all of us. So to me, this idea of artistic freedom, and rather than hopefully cultural appropriation, it's more about cultural celebration of being, living in America and sitting here tonight and being part of this discussion that I'm concerned with. And so there's, as far as I'm concerned, I'm always learning. There's still lots of learning to do, but I'm always excited about this discussion. But I'm cultural appropriation, I don't get it.
Well, I'm kind of answering both questions because I had a show this season, Dames at Sea. And for those of you who don't know that show, it was first produced 50 years ago, 1966, in New York City. And there's a song in that musical called Singapore Sue. And Singapore Sue is a direct reference and an homage to another song called Shanghai Lil that was in the 1933 film Footlight Parade. That particular production number is performed by Jimmy Cagney and Ruby Keeler. And of course, in 1933, Miss Keeler is in what you would call full stereotypical Asian wardrobe, hair, makeup, and using a very bad, thick accent. So you flash forward now to a possible Broadway revival, and we thought, why don't we just cut the number? Because it is not a book song, meaning it doesn't further the plot at all. It is a full-out production number. But that was not an option with the estates. None of the writers are alive on Dames at Sea, and it would be very interesting to hold a conversation with them today, as you would with a living writer if they were working on the show while you were reviving it, but that was not our case. All three are gone. So we did get permission from the estates and the lawyers to re-examine the song and to rewrite any lyrics that we felt were inappropriate or what would be needed to do. So I took it on as a really joyful responsibility and a real personal responsibility to make sure that nothing in the staging or the lyrics or the dance, the movement, the overall look of the song, also importantly, how the song sounded, how it was going to be sung, and how the orchestration was going to be created for this particular number. And I didn't want any of the audience to be conjuring up any of those really stereotypical images from the films and television, because they're so powerful and they live with us forever and they are so strong. I love the idea of borrowing intelligently, that when we were talking about that phrase. So I was also very lucky to have some Asian American students who study with me when I'm teaching my dance classes here in New York City, and also quite a few Asian students who are over here on educational visas. They came to the previews, and I was able to speak directly to each one of those students, and I said, tell me what you think, tell me what you like, what you don't like. We included them in all of the discussion on the ongoing process, so it was a really good guide. I felt that we accomplished what we had to do with the estates, putting up a number that could have been very insensitive. I got the approval from everybody that did see it that was from the Asian American community, and I did not feel artistically compromised one bit. I was very happy to approach this, and it was a challenge, and I really enjoyed doing it, meeting that challenge.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Okay, so we said that we wanted to do a lot tonight, and this next piece, I want to thank all the panelists for responding to those two questions, just as a way of just getting us started, actually, just teeing us up for this next piece, which is to support you all in having a conversation. So, we would like to encourage you all to we've got a couple of questions that we want to share with you as prompts, and I believe that those questions are going to be on the screen behind me shortly. You're going to have an opportunity now to break out in small groups. I'd like to encourage you to do a couple of things. Before you start moving, I need your attention. I can already feel the energy, folks, are starting to stay with me. Particularly you two that are passing things back and forth, stay with us. Yes, thank you. Okay, you are going to, I'd like to encourage you to move your chairs just a little bit, not too much, because at break time, we're going to need to still, after break, we're going to come back and you'll be in this formation. But see if you can huddle up together, cluster together with about five other people. Get up and move. Don't talk to folks that you came here with, that you already know, that are your best friends. This is an opportunity for us to really get to engage one another around some questions and some issues outside of our comfort zone. So I'd like to encourage you to do that. So huddle up in groups of about five. If there's that sixth person hanging out, include them. You can go to six and move. Don't be in your comfort zone. And then we're going to give you about 15 minutes. No, it's not a lot of time, but you'll have two questions to think about, reflect on. We really want, in addition to what you heard on stage. Okay, so we're going to start that shortly. I just want to make sure the questions are there. So how are we doing the questions? Because there's two questions that they're going to reflect on. You want them to reflect on one first, and then we'll show the slide for the second one, or yeah? No. They're going to be rotating? Okay, wonderful. So you'll have two questions. The second one is going to rotate up. And you'll hear me let you know when you've got 5 minutes warning, and I'll let you know when you've got a 1 minute warning. And we'll come back, and I'll give you further instructions after that. So let's go ahead and get started. Huddle up. Thank you.
Huh.
Was that a hand over here?
Do I need to stand?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, I'm Melissa Slaughter. We had 2 points that I think we would most like to be addressed. One, they were both questions that we discussed amongst ourselves. Question one was, should brown/yellowface include when Asian actors are specifically portraying characters or stereotypes? Is that a form of yellowface? In addition, how does yellow and brownface affect specifically actors of mixed race?
Did everybody hear that?
No.
Can you repeat that piece, I think? I want to make sure I got that. Not everybody heard that in the back, which is, does brownface and yellowface include actors of color playing stereotypical roles?
Yep.
Is that a part of brownface and yellowface? And then the other one was, how do we reconcile actors who are mixed race? How do we factor that into the conversation? Okay, thank you. I thought I heard another group. Saw a hand over to my chair. There's one and then two over here. There's one back there and then two over here.
Hi, William Lex Ham. In our group, we really decided... Yeah, my name is William Lexham. In our group, we really decided, just personally ourselves, that we're going to really not accept any racist roles. I'm pretty sure most of us don't here accept any racist roles, and also speak out against those. And I think with many Asians in America, we feel that, you know, when we are speaking out, we don't want to be the ones that are causing kind of trouble, or you don't want to be the person that is maybe unworkable with, and you know, you develop that reputation. So I think we're just, you know, fucking tired of it, and you know, and we're just gonna stop doing that and really speak out no matter what, and also support anyone else who also speaks out, and you know, not let them stand alone completely.
Hi, I'm Alex Chester. We came up with some things for the how to erase Orientalism, and we thought, you know, create new works. Obviously, new works are being created by people of color, but in order to get that produced, we need to have people of color behind the casting table that are heads of theater companies, and we need to get more of that. Do you guys want to say anything? That's what I think.
Hi, I'm Joanna Carpenter. Hello? Okay, great. We kind of just... just in terms of being able to stand up and say no when you're presented with the option to perpetuate a stereotype, to use an accent in an audition if you don't normally speak with an accent. Another thing that we kind of had fun discussing is money. Production side, money at driver of fear from a perspective, mitigating risk when it's easier to cast a white person in a role. It's less risky, so you save money that way, theoretically. A driver of just general perceptions and the perpetuations of old stereotypical kind of crap ideals about Asians and any performers of color in the entertainment world.
Thank you. Yes, we have time for some more. I see a hand here. And
well, I guess Pun gave me the microphone. Anyway, I'm Erin Quill. I'm the fairy princess. I hear Nygasp has a big file on me. Hi, Nygasp. How you doing? I want to address just one thing about mixed race actors. Mixed race actors, of which I am one, can play anything and everything that their experience and background allows them to play, that the way they see themselves in the morning is the way they should conduct themselves on stage and off. That's how I feel. I feel like if you look in the mirror and you see a person that can represent a storyline and a character, then that's what you should play. And I don't think you should limit yourself by saying, I don't look Asian enough, or I look too Asian to do something. And it really is an issue for mixed race people. It is an issue within the Asian community, even the Asian acting community in and of themselves, because we aren't just white and Asian. We are black and Asian. We are South Asian, East Asian. There are so many different colors and experiences within a mixed race person that we all have to acknowledge that the Asian American community in America constantly is changing and updating itself. And so it is not upon us to look at mixed race people and decide when and where they fit. So then the other part is, in terms of speaking up, I know a little bit about speaking up. Maybe a little bit more than most people would want to know. I would say that speaking up is an intrinsic part of how you have to conduct yourself. You have to go around with honor. I think that's something that, as an Asian American, as an Irish American, I try to conduct myself with honor whenever I confront a situation. So if I feel that speaking up in a situation is what needs to happen, then that's what I do. And sometimes that leads to change, and sometimes that just leads to more unemployment for myself. That's the risk you have to take. But I think if you take anything from this, it's that you can be a warrior of change in and of yourself. When you get up in the morning, you arm yourself and you go out and you live your life to the best and fullest it can be. And you don't let other people define you. You constantly define yourself. So that's what I would say about how to change it.
Thank you. One, two, three, four. Come here, one, two, three, four. So we'll bring mics to you. Let's hear from those people. You've already got a mic.
Great.
The one, two, three, and four that we spoke to, we'll get mics to you.
Great. I'm David Nguyen. Something that my group talked about was that we wanted to work towards awareness and collaboration, because it's 2016. The fact that yellowface and brownface exists is ridiculous. But how do you have those conversations when the powers that be, at best, treat race as a non-issue, and at worst, without trying, it's not looking at it through a punitive mindset, it's not shaming anyone, but trying to have a point of discussion, at worst, when it's treated with pushback, how do you have a discussion when people refuse to have the discussion? This is a point that we were elaborating on.
Thank you. Yes, Mark?
I think it's really incumbent on the white folks in the room to decide what you're going to do, who you're going to talk to, how we're going to educate ourselves, how we are creating awareness, how we're talking to other white folks about these issues. Our friends of color should not be the ones who are saying no. We need to be saying no. We're at the table. There are a lot of rooms that we're in. And so I'm standing here going, who's not in this room right now? And there's a lot of people who make a lot of decisions who aren't in this room. And I'm going, oh, I should have done more Facebook posts. I should have actually called more people. I should have actually. So even in moments like this, what we can each do, the white folks who have a lot of power, those of us on the stage, those of us not, I run a small organization. I'm a white dude. I've got a lot of opportunity, right? I got a lot of opportunity there. So, my role in my dream world is that the white folks are doing a lot of self-awareness and education. And there are ways to do that. And if you're a white person and you need to know how to do that, I can help support that and know lots of people who can support you. But we need to be talking to people who aren't in this room, the other white folks who are here. So white folks, if you need some support, I'm here for you. We have to, it's incumbent on us to actually make the ecosystem healthier. We cannot depend on people of color anymore to be doing the fight. People cannot just fight on their own. We have to step forward and just realize that we always have blind spots. So anyway, thank you.
I'm Christine Bruno, and I'm just going to be quick and piggyback right off of what Michael and Carmen just said. That, yes, we need white folks who are allies, of which I am a white person. I'm also a person with a disability. And we all, as underrepresented groups, need to be allies to each other. Because if we're not allies to each other, none of this is going to ever go away. So I need to, the reason I'm here is because I'm an ally to all of you. And that's how we're going to erase all these forms of blackface, brownface, cripface, redface, all of it, is to be allies to each other.
Hi, my name is Kevin Jones. This is my group I was with, and I asked this question because it was really because of the lack of my knowledge and my ignorance of words, and I asked, and I got this response that I didn't think I was going to get. They had this, they were struck, and this question I asked resonated with them, and I didn't expect that. But the question was, what is Orientalism? And I got a lot of mms, but I thought everyone was going to be like, oh, it's this and this, and I was like, oh, okay, so, yeah.
Thank you.
you want to add to that quickly? Anyone from the panel want to speak to that? Okay. Yes.
Hi, thanks so much for asking that question. I think a lot of our conversations here are taking a very social justice bent, and in theories and our understanding of white supremacy and the cultural hegemony that manifests itself in theater right now is that there are three prongs to it. One of it is the whitewashing of American history and the deletion of the genocide of Native Americans and Mexican people of this continent. And it is the slavery and exploitation of labor through the racist history of this country and the capitalist forces that maintain it. And when we talk about cultural appropriation, it is not just the exploitation of people, but it is the theft of our histories and our stories for the profit of other people, mainly white people, and the erasure of our own participation in the telling of our own stories. But Orientalism, it's its third form and third leg, and Orientalism is the perpetual making of an enemy, and the enemy being Asians. And you don't see it right now as Chinese people because China is just an economic threat. But when you think about Asian American and its inclusion of Muslim voices and the way we understand Arab Americans in this country, you see directly how the other, the Asian other, is a direct enemy to your safety. And that is why we are not included in the history of America, but made a perpetual other. And those are the three prongs that we really need to align with across colors to defeat and overthrow this overarching narrative that it is completely screwing us over.
Thank you. So let's just hear from these two folks, and then we're going to begin a conversation with the audience and the panelists, okay? Is there support for that? Okay, great. Let's hear from these folks. Somebody say that you go next.
Okay. Hi, I'm Eliana Innocencio. To pick off of that, thank you for bringing that up, because for the first time, I learned I'm Filipino. Filipinos were put on play at Asian-Americans, and I just learned that from a BuzzFeed article. I should not be getting good news or history from a BuzzFeed. There's that. But my group here was wonderful. First of all, obviously, it's up to the creative team to be... Great. Thank you.
It's up to the creative team to be learning about the people that they want to cast. If they want to cast, they will find the information. Right here in our own group is Lori. She's from Pennsylvania. She came from her theater to this event to find someone to be in her show, and she wanted to find an authentic experience. Now that's good creative work. Another thing we talked about was that don't think that your audience members are dumb. They will go and watch what you put up there because they want to learn. We are in a cultured community, right? So we are all open to learning. We are open to finding out more about what history, what culture is out there. We were talking about her experience as an actor. She went in for Glass Menagerie. They said that they couldn't cast her, though, because where would they find a mother that's white or black? Like, how could they cast that? Because she's half Asian. That's not right. Louis C.K. did it. He cast a mother for his children that was black, and when asked why did he do it, he said she was the best person for the role. That should be everybody.
Hi there, Alan Declan Fong here, and we were discussing that amongst Asians, we're generally keep to ourselves and we're quiet about our concerns. It's great that we have this community now, but we should start shaming these actors or directors who are taking these Asian roles, like Scarlett Johansson in Ghost in the Shell. Tilda Swinton. Tilda Swinton and Dr. Strange and Emma Stone, we love you, but...
No, we don't.
No, but no, you're a bitch. You're a bitch. No, not yet. We love you, but you're a bitch. Correct. Thank you.
Okay, so we need to just remind us of the ground rules.
the thing that is the problem, the methodologies that we use. So we can't use, you know, somebody, give me an Omni-Lore quote. We're not going to be able to use the same oppressive tools, systems, language that we're working against. So I just want to, we're in support philosophically. We get you, and we also know that the frustration is real. But again, we just have to be mindful. We are the ones that we're waiting for to do a lot of this work, so we just have to support each other. Okay. Can we have a conversation now with the panelists? You heard earlier them tee it up with a broad perspective and response to the two questions that we led with. I want to encourage you all to feel free to ask questions directly of them and have an exchange if you all are ready to do that.
Hi, my name is Chris Peters. This has been an amazing year on Broadway for Asian performers. We had Allegiance, we had Ruth Ann Miles on the tour last year. One of us, our own thing, this is Skyler, Hamilton. And it feels that like 2016 was a suspension mark year for diversity, and that 2017, at least from what I've seen so far, it seems like the momentum is dying a little bit in terms of opportunities and things like that, especially with the return of this my God, which I know, just speaking for myself, I know there's some mixed feelings about the quality of roles. So my question is, should we feel that way, that the momentum is slowly kind of dying off with 2017? And also, is progress really the quantity of roles, or should we really be thinking about the quality in terms of what roles we're playing rather than just prostitutes and being consulting and things like that? So, what's my question?
Okay, thank
I can try and respond a little bit following Broadway. Shows take a while to come to fruition, so if we see something this year, the knock-on effect may occur in 4 or 5 years, but then again, it may not. Allegiance didn't do great at the box office, okay, any artistic concerns aside. One thing that you can do is when there are shows and the kind of representation that you want to see, go, right? Encourage other people to go. Buy tickets. Sometimes, I mean, we all want excellence, right? We all want excellence. We don't want anyone to sort of, get a pass just because. But sometimes I just want to see representation even more than I want to see excellence. I just want to see, it was so exciting in Allegiance to see all of those bodies on that stage and people who you knew were not getting a chance in other shows. And so what you might think of the show aside, that's wonderful. So if something like that comes up, go, try to get other people to go, try and support it, and then hopefully it, you know, spills out to wider communities, because producers want to make good work, but they also want to make their money back. And so if you can show them an example that, yes, this is going to work, this is why Hamilton is a great example, right? You can have a multicultural cast, and guess what? People are still going to come, even if it's not starring a white person. Oh, my God. So if you can help make that happen, that can help to increase the diversity. So just try and go, and try and get other people to go.
Wonderful, thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Yes. Mia. In terms of the your feeling that we have lost our momentum, I think these things are very cyclical. It was a little bit upsetting to me personally to hear that. Not upsetting. I mean, the data is terrific that the representation of Asian Americans has increased, but that's because The King and I has come back. You know, we have Allegiance, and all of a sudden there's this false sense that we are making inroads, but we're not really. I mean, there's good, The King and I, Miss Saigon will all be here, which will bump the numbers up again. The exact same shows that were being touted as the kind of new wave 20 years ago, you know? So, yes, supporting the big Broadway shows, but also they're not so big to be consistently present in all of those things, because it takes a long, long, long time, and it is our responsibility to make as much noise as we can in whatever way we can. But, you know, and you talk to people, you talk to the people in the panels, and you say, this is a good thing to do, this is what our country looks like, and it's like constant advocacy.
Thank you. Okay, we've got another question.
Hi, my name's Marissa Marquez. I actually wrote a play called Ms. Oriental, and we're part of an Asian lady army that is rising. And the reason I started writing is because when I went to college, I actually was part of a mostly white community, and that never bothered them. It was only until I came to New York where that became a problem. Now, my issue is, how do you stop institutionalizing, you know, the issue of, what's that word? Racism, yes. Institutionalized racism. Because a lot of, there was a certain incident that we talked about. I'm not going to appropriate his story, but basically, when you're in an education system that says that if you're not white, if the shows we're doing aren't allowed to have non-white characters in it, how do you stop that? Because if it starts with education, where can we really build it inside the education system?
Okay, thank you. Anyone want to respond, even from the audience? Anyone on stage?
Sure, I'll talk about this briefly. So institutional racism, right, is not just theater institutions, but it's educational institutions. It's racism is a systemic issue. And I think that part of the things that, one of the great things about working with Carmen at Art Equity and starting to understand racism in a deeper way is getting to see how many leaders of educational arts institutions have come to value this and understand that the way we've been attacking diversity and inclusion issues before has not been effective. And so I think that, and I know having started doing this work with places like the New School and places like NYU, that there are educational institutions that are reaching out and understand that they have inherent blind spots and that they are creating and that their institutions have historically not been friendly to students of color and artists of color. They're just now starting to understand that they're not necessarily creating a safe environment. As more and more facilitators and more people that are aware, and quite frankly, this entire generation that's like 5 to 10 years younger than I am, that's coming up, you guys are so incredibly articulate in being able to talk about things like microaggressions, things like systemic racism, things like white privilege. In some ways, it's partly on them to do the educating. And part of the exhausting thing here, and I'm so glad that Michael brought this up, is that it is exhausting as an artist of color to constantly have to educate your white people. It really is.
Does anybody else want to add? We're talking about educational institutions, and I see several hands. Are these new questions, or are folks speaking to this issue? Okay, do you want to come grab a...
So I can speak to an educational perspective on this question. A junior at Princeton University, and we have been talking a lot about the issue, what we can do to increase diversity in the art, especially theater, which we have noticed has an extreme tendency to go white and Anglo-white. And I'm in a class called Movements for Diversity in American Theater, and we've been starting to have a series of conversations on race and the arts. And first, we noticed that there has been a lack of diversity. And then second, we created a task force, a committee on race in the arts, and we talk about what can we do to recruit freshmen, to show freshmen who are colored students that there is accessibility for them to be able to get involved in theater. We discussed several initiatives, such as creating a funding pool to support cultural theater groups, which tend not to get a lot of support from the department or the university. And it's important to be able to support those cultural theater groups, which there are several. Another initiative would be to hire professors of color for your arts department. It's really important to see examples of professionals that students of color can look up to. I think that's really important.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that there were just a few more hands, and then we want to get maybe one more question, and I'm being told that we'll need to try to transition. So to the issue of what we need to do in educational institutions, the academy. Were there hands still for that?
There's one over here.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Brandon Smith. So basically, I think a way to facilitate an idea, I mean, basically getting representation. I mean, seeing people on stage that look like you. So that's just a collective of people actually doing that themselves. Like you said earlier with Hamilton, like having people, people of color on stage can actually, make money, and like people want to go see that. It's the whole thing. It's like, we have to, I'm especially like the new generation, like we have to make our own work. And that's basically what it is. Like, we have to make that for ourselves. We have to write that. We have to do that. And no one else can see that, because whatever we see, just like the new writers, like, we have to do that for ourselves, because no one will see that. No one knows those stories. No one knows those ideas, because they're in our bodies. They're in our heads. And that's our job. Yeah, so.
Thank you. Thank you. One more, and then we'll take one more new question before we run out. I see more hands than we have time for. I need some help from folks who are out there running with the mics. Go for it.
I think we can take two more.
Okay. Hi, my name's Destiny. I'm a casting director. And I wanted to ask what casting professionals and talent reps can do to support Asian American actors.
Great question. Does it? Okay, so someone said, take our business cards. Anyone else want to speak to that? I mean, it feels like there's a lot of actors in the audience. Anybody want to speak to that? Yes.
I'll chime in. I mean, right now, we have a lot of really strong companies, NatCo, and many others. I'm sorry, I can't getting nervous right now. And I'm an actor, go fig. We have a lot of companies in New York City, and being very fresh and new to the scene, I've seen a lot of groups gathering up and creating work for, you know, people of color, and especially with the Asian American community. And if those groups could also reach out to the institutions, the universities, the schools, bring those shows to those schools to show them, you know, Awake and Sing at Princeton, or oh, really? Oh, I don't. I'm sorry. I'm like I said, I'm still very new to this. Or, you know, Lloyd, your work, seeing them at, you know, things, you know, in NYU or even down in Texas, you know, blow their minds that, you know, there is a voice that we have to show them in all parts of the United States. I'm from Hawaii, and yo, we colorblind cast all the time. I can't tell you how many times I've seen different multi-ethnic Cinderellas. That's crazy. I mean, I played the Herald. That was nuts, you know, and I think that that's where we can start as far as bringing out the work that these wonderful people do to the universities, to show them, the professors and the students, that there is work, you know?
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, and I think it's also about encouraging as many people to come as possible if the show it matches their level of technique. We just saw over 200 girls last Monday for a big tour of 42nd Street. Out of 200, there were 3 African-American girls and only, I think, 4 to 5 Asian-American girls. Now, we have cast one, so I'm very thrilled about that. We have an African-American girl, because it was based on the dance audition that everybody got a crack that came. There was no typing. It was just you walk forward, you learn the combinations, and then you dance, and if you have that level of technique, you are considered for the show. But it was a lack of the numbers, too, and I don't know how you get the word out, or the casting agents. Oh, we have open calls. We have the agent calls.
Money. Money. It all has to do with money. For dancers, there are fewer and fewer African-American dancers because there's no funding for scholarships.
Like in the college.
Thank you.
Well, they're working all the time, too. They're working nonstop, yes.
Okay. I've been told that we have time for one new question, and then we're going to need to wrap up. And I see a lot of hands. And you all heard us say that we were just going to scratch the surface of these issues. So I'm being reminded that we'd like to encourage you to write ideas, thoughts, concepts on these post-it notes. And if you could, on your way out, please post them on the chart paper that's on the two sides of the room. And know that this is a national initiative that is just being launched. So we're going to be having more and more of these conversations. And so can I get support for just one more person? Yes, go for it.
My question is about the unrealistic expectations of Asian American actors, writers, and directors when they do perform and they happen to fail, but we constantly see failures from white artists all the time, and they are invited back to the table over and over again. But artists of color, specifically Asian Americans, are constantly held to a higher standard, and when they are not met, they are cut. So I would like to know how we are going to combat that at the future, to ignore the bad review, the one bad performance, the one bad opportunity that we've had, and then have all opportunities after that erased.
Thank you. Okay. That might be a good question for us to go out on. There are folks on this panel who might be able to speak to that.
No, I mean, I've learned so much tonight. I guess I'm a little naive, particularly in the educational department, because if it's more of a lack of minorities getting into the colleges or because of how expensive it is, this is where I'm a little confused. Or if it's that there's not colorblind casting in universities today, because that's the world that's so safe. There's no commercial pressure to make money.
Thank you.
founder of San Diego Asian Artists Ensemble. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Erica Kramer-Ricketts, Managing Director of Treatment Arts, Asian American Artists in Kansas City, Missouri. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Joel Belafonte, New York City. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
Hi, I'm Kim Kreitz, member of Philly Asian Performing Artists. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Randy Reyes, removed from the arts in Twin Cities, Minnesota. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Isha Kim, creative director of Philadelphia Asian Performing Arts. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Amy Meyer, police and artistic director of Fordham, Arts, Kansas City, Missouri. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I am Nina Maria, artistic director for Crowded Fire Theater in San Francisco. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Leslie Ishii.
In Los Angeles, California.
Stand with us against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Yumin Chen, members of Philly Asian Performing Artists. Stand with me against Yellowface and Brownface.
I'm Charles Pena.
Right now, I want to call to my friends at AAPAC to come and
November. This is where this all started, where it was just a bunch of Asian artists in a room trying to actualize some solutions and brainstorm some solutions to this. And we were thinking that it would be great if we could somehow write a manifesto that could explain our position, could describe what we stood for, what we wanted to see, and in conjunction with a couple of other manifestos, actually they were being written at the same time at the TCD conference. Leslie Ishii was working on one there. We compiled this. Some of this is also in response to what you have brought into the room as well. As we launch this national initiative, this is the manifesto that we stand for. Yellowface and brownface erases our bodies, our voices, our humanity. It is a conscious choice that imposes others' idea of who we are and reinforces a narrative of white supremacy. We Asian American theater artists across the country stand united against it, will speak out to oppose it, and empower each other to ensure it stops here now.
Our cultures are rich and varied. Our traditions are specific and have meaning, evolving over thousands of years of civilization. Our culture is not a costume, not a concept. Our landscapes are not exotic backdrops. Our locations are not mythic.
We demand an American theater that reflects the world in which we live, re-examines worlds we thought we knew, and imagines worlds that could be possible.
We are heroes, villains, lovers, slayers, neighbors, idols, deadbeats, and your immediate family members. We are funny, but not the punchline to your joke. We are serious, but also emotional and passionate. We are not mystical nor magical. We are much, much more than just our race.
Our theater community to see our talent, even if it comes in a package that you didn't expect. Recognize our potential and take greater artistic risks. Hear us and ask questions if you don't know the answer. Provide the space for us to arrive at the answers together.
Make us a vital part of the fabric of your world. Believe that we are an integral part of your American story. Thank you. Stop casting our African-American and Latino brethren in Asian roles, causing them to misappropriate our cultures and pitting us against each other.
Educate your audiences, but don't underestimate them either. Recognize that the playing field is not equal. Privileges are bestowed to some and not to others.
Question histories that contain an ethnocentric worldview. Allow for multiple points of view to coexist. Acknowledge that universality and relatability have nothing to do with race.
Don't ignore other people's pain in your rush to defend your position. If you have hurt them, even if you didn't intend to, make it a priority to understand why.
Seek to destroy institutional biases where they exist. Apply more rigor and creativity to your dramaturgy, programming, hiring, and outreach practices. Work to create inclusion everywhere you see it. Show us through your actions, not your words. In turn,
we will speak out against injustices and strive to communicate our perspective openly and honestly. We will work to support each other, recognizing our own blind spots and biases. We will create the work that we want to see.
We will continue to define Asian American for ourselves through our varied permutations. In partnership with our allies, we will work to enrich our communities through our artistry.
In so doing, we hope to unearth stories left behind, to find new ways of expressing the true complexities of our world, to give voice to a more vibrant and rich theatrical landscape, to inspire future generations of artists, and in so doing, expand the art form. Stand with us.
Before we go on our separate ways this evening, I wanted to make sure you took a moment to thank our amazing facilitator, Carmen Morgan. Finally, the party is actually not over yet. We're going to have another conversation if you want, but with alcohol. Yeah. So I believe it's going to be at the lobby bar at the Empire Bar, which is just 3 blocks uptown from here. And if you don't know where it is, come see me afterwards. Empire Bar.
We're getting it up.
Okay. In the meantime, I just really wanted to thank you from the bottom of all of our hearts for spending your Monday evening with us. It's a school night. You do not take that for granted. Please get home safely, and we look forward to making change with each and every one of you.
Work hard, very